I'm not here to make any apologies for lecture courses. I think we're going to continue to have lecture courses as long as we have allow students to choose the courses they want. And I'm glad that my students take one of the courses that I teach. I teach a gen ed course in the college called First Nights. And it's about what it was like to be present at the first performances of five famous pieces of classical music. And we add to those five a new piece that is commissioned every year and is given its first performance at the last lecture hall, at the last lecture meeting, with interviews of the composer and the performers and the meeting before that, so that we have ourselves the experience of bringing into the world a new piece of art. And the students who write about that premiere have the same experience. They put into their paper about our premiere the kind of information that we wish we had about the five premieres we've studied, so that when their paper is used in the source book for First Nights 100 years from now and this piece is taught, their paper will be primary evidence. It's taught in Sanders Theater. It's taught at 10 o'clock in the morning, and everybody comes in at 10:06 and a half with wet hair. Students seem to think that 10:06 in the morning is very, very, very early. And I guess it is for some. It's a course about how to listen to music. It's a course about these five great pieces. And it features a lot of performances. We have live performances for many of these things, including, of course, the premiere at the end. And so it's about all those things. But what it's really about, as far as I'm concerned, is to try to convince the students who take it of how lucky they are to be alive on a planet that has music like this on it, and that they were born with all the equipment they need if they have a pair of ears, a memory, a rational facility, and a heart. And so what my hope is to make their lives better. And it's not inconceivable that in a Sanders Theater with a bunch of people, all of whom want to get into medical school or work for Goldman Sachs or be elected president of the United States, that there may be one or two people who will one day be in a position to affect the place of the arts in our culture. And so it's not, as far as I'm concerned, a waste of time. It's a lecture, and so I try really hard to sort of make it worth their while to get out of bed. There should be a big grand piano here, and I would run to it. I would run to the blackboard. I trip over the wires. I run around trying to make it a lively experience. So here's a sort of a quick tour through one of the pieces we deal with, the one that everybody thinks they don't like. Here is Mr. Igor Stravinsky, painted in 1913, the year that the score of his ballet, The Rite of Spring, was premiered in Paris. It was a very ultra-modern city. Think of 1913, technology is going to take us everywhere. We have electric lights. We have the metro underground. We have trains everywhere. We have aeroplanes. We have a thing called the cinema. They have a thing called the théâtrophone, where if you subscribe, they bring a wire into your house and you can listen to a theatrical or music performance that's going on in a theater right now without having to leave your house. Marcel Proust listened to Debussy's famous opera several times using his théâtrophone subscription. And in fact, there was a kind of thing, you usually had to go to a place where you had a membership. You had a membership in a salon des phonographes. There was a thing called the phonograph. Now, let me try to see if I can explain this. A phonograph is a device that allows you to listen to music that is not being played now. Isn't that amazing? Just astounding. Well, until this phonograph came along, as you know, the only music you could ever listen to was music that was happening where you were, when you were. All this is going to happen, and next year the First World War is going to break out, and our approach to technology is never going to be the same. But that's a different lecture, a different story. We have super modern stuff, and we also have the most cutting-edge avant-garde thing, which is the ballet company, the Russian ballet, directed by Serge Diaghilev, and here he is. There's a lot to be said about him, which I won't say now. We will just say that there was this amazing event in the brand new Théâtre des Champs-Élysées, ultra-modern, built with concrete construction so you don't need pillars to hold the balconies up. And in this theater was given the first performance of the ballet, The Rite of Spring. You have to picture what it was like. This is a very famous premiere because it's the piece that has the famous riot. What they say is the audience was shouting so loud that the dancers of the Diaghilev Ballet Company could not hear this gigantic orchestra that was playing right below their feet. They couldn't hear it. And the conductor kept going in case, as he said, in case of a lull in the hubbub, they would hear us playing. And Vaslav Nijinsky, the choreographer of the Rite of Spring, was in his tailcoat because, although he danced earlier in the program and would dance later, he put on his tailcoat expecting to come out and take a ballet, a bow after the Rite of Spring as choreographer. And Stravinsky, who was furious because of all the noise, went backstage. Nijinsky, choreographer, is standing on a chair in the wings screaming numbers in Russian to the dancers so that they can keep together while Stravinsky is holding the tails of his coat so that Nijinsky won't fall over and roll onto the stage. Imagine that scene, and you can see why this is such a famous piece of theater, at least, stage business, whether or not anybody heard anything, whether that would have been the performance to go to. Everybody says they were there, and half the people who said they were there weren't there at the very first performance. The first dancing that happens in the Rite of Spring is dancing to a chord that just gets repeated over and over and over and over again, the same chord. There are sounds in the Rite of Spring that are just amazing things that he discovers. This sound, like that. It's this plus this. So two very nice chords. Plus what do you think? And it happens many, many times. You may know it. And how do you listen to something that's just the same thing over and over again? Well, you might do it by thinking along these lines here. Now I have to, let's try this. Do you follow the idea here? That it's the same thing, but it has accents from time to time. So you could hear them as a group of nine followed by a group of two and something like that. Why don't we hear them that way? I don't. It's because Stravinsky sets a clock going before the chords begin. He goes, bum, 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 bum. And we say, okay, I get it. I'm supposed to listen to groups of four. One, two, three, four, one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four. And if you listen that way, then you end up with something that looks a little bit like the other side of the handout you have today, which may be a little bit hard to follow. But what it is a picture of that whole first dance with an indication of the chord itself, which I write down only one time, the chord. Watch the screen there. Then four more measures and goes on. But I think you see what I mean, that when you hear it in groups of four, you hear the accents, and there are all sorts of patterns, and there's lots more we could, with a lot of time and patience, do with that, but we won't. That chord was important to Stravinsky, and that chord that you just heard played many, many times appears in his sketchbook at the very top of the very first page of his sketches for the Rite of Spring. Even though there's a prelude that happens, that's the first music that's danced when the curtain goes up. And Stravinsky was well aware, I think, of that chord.
Reaching Switzerland in the fall, I rented a house in Clarens for my family and began to work.
I put the piano on this wall. I worked from the beginning of the day to the end of the day. I continued to work after the dinner. When I was very, very tired, I went to bed. And I remember I slept very well.
And I put on the door, it is here, in French, it is here that I I am composing the Sacre du Printemps, and I cite Igor Stravinsky.
I like very much this cornet. Rather a new chord, you know, or eight notes chord, but the accents were even more new. And the accents were really the foundation of the whole thing.
When I finished composing the Rite of Spring, I played it for Diaghilev.
And I started to play him this chord, 59 times the same chord. Diaghilev was a little bit surprised. He didn't want to offend me. He asked me only one thing, which was very offending. He asked me, will it last a very long time this way? And I said, till the end, my dear. And he was silent, because he understood that the answer was serious.
Well, Stravinsky, he's cute, but Stravinsky is a liar. He misrepresented a lot of things about the Rite of Spring, because in the year after the first performance, the original conductor performed it as a concert piece, and it was something of a success. And so Stravinsky spent the rest of his time trying to separate the Rite of Spring from the original collaboration, where it was a part, where there were many people who together made this the work of art that it was. And it's those people and that collaboration that I like to try to reestablish, despite Stravinsky's best efforts to make it his own work that could be choreographed by any number of people. Among the people here is a man who sent his two sons to Harvard. This is Nikolai Rorik, the great painter, set designer, but he was thought also to be an archaeologist and an expert in primitive Slavic culture. It is he who devised the scenario for the Rite of Spring. Stravinsky lies and says, I thought it up, but we know it's not true because we have correspondence between the two. He also he was a painter, and his painting, we don't have the original sets for the Rite of Spring, but a lot of his paintings are about Slavic ancestry. This is a painting called The Ancestors, and as we all, we Slavs know, the ancestors of the Slavs are bears, and that's why when the ancestors are evoked near the end of the Rite of Spring, people wearing bear skins appear on stage. And here's a thing called The Sacrifice, which looks very much like the sacrificial circle at the end of the Rite of Spring, in which the chosen sacrificial victim is required to dance herself to death. We do have this sketch of Rorik's for the curtain that came down between the two halves of the Rite of Spring. The first half is a lot of games and a lot of war games and love games and sex games played between groups of the tribe. The second half is mostly female and has this women's dance that chooses one person who at the end dances herself to death. Between the two is this curtain. A woman named Valentine Gross made her living by doing pastel sketches live in real time in the backs of darkened Paris theaters. And this is her sketch of part one of the Rite of Spring. We have some idea of what the set looked like, and you can see that there are groups of dancers dancing. And her sketch for part two of the Rite of Spring, where the sacrificial victim standing immobile in white has just been chosen, and the women of the tribe dance in a circle around her. All of that, a few original costumes survive, and people who seem to know about this, of my Slavic friends, say, oh, yeah, there are certain areas of the Slavic world where that's a perfectly plausible kind of theatrical version of local costume. So not to forget Rorik as an important part of this collaboration. Equally important, maybe more so, is the great Vaslav Nijinsky, one of the great dancers who ever lived, as you know. He was the Nureyev of his time. He was the everything. And people said about him what people almost always say about great dancers, big leaps. He just said, well, I just jump up and stay as long as I'm supposed to, and then I come down again. Cat-like motion, all that kind of thing, great athleticism. And he was a wonderful dancer. This is his costume for a famous solo turn of his called The Spectre of the Rose. This is not a Esther Williams bathing cap. It's actually a rose costume where he dances with Karsavina. But the year before the Rite of Spring, Diaghilev had made Nijinsky the choreographer of the company. That enraged a lot of people because the previous choreographer, Massin, was an excellent choreographer, and people knew that Diaghilev was in love with Nijinsky and figured that he had made him the choreographer for some reason other than purely artistic ones. The fact is, though, that the ballets Nijinsky did choreograph are really amazing. One is a ballet called Afternoon of a Faun, set to Debussy's music. And the way it worked is Nijinsky trying to create a kind of a Greek frieze, an antique Greek frieze effect, in which you see bodies frontally, but arms and heads sideways. So it's sort of an antique low relief, and a lot of the ballet is danced that way. There's a particular choreographic look. This one ends with a famous, probably masturbatory gesture with a scarf that got everybody upset, except for Diaghilev, who was delighted when everybody is upset. He also danced, choreographed a ballet called Jeux, Games, to music commissioned from Debussy. And this was a ballet about the game of tennis, but also the game of love. It begins with a tennis ball bouncing onto the stage. Somebody comes in pursuit of the tennis ball. Somebody comes in pursuit of the person. Oh, you end up with three people on the stage, and it ends with a very famous three-way kiss, which also shocked everybody. The whole ballet, just about the whole ballet, is danced on what dancers would call half point, sort of, again, a specific choreography, as though you were sort of in the middle of a tennis serve the whole time. He was actually looking for a particular look. And for the Rite of Spring, he also chose a particular look because we're supposed to be dealing with, I hate to use the word, but they used it then, primitive Slavic culture, ritualistic actions done by a tribe long in the past. So he's trying to do something that is as unballettic as possible. So does anybody here know ballet dancers? You know you can tell a ballet dancer because they walk down the street like this. It's what they call turnout. That is that you turn your feet out like this. You know they have all these ballet positions like that, including ones where you have to do, you know, that kind of thing. It's about turnout. It's about point work. It's about arms. And it's about beautiful virtuoso solos with people in tutus being held up by men, and then the men do the solo with a big leap and stuff like that. Those are the things that classical ballet is about. And those are, in fact, the things that the people went to see the Diaghilev ballet perform better than anybody else in the world. So Nijinsky says, I'm just going to do the opposite of all those things. Instead of turnout, I'm going to have people put their toes together and put their legs together, lock their knees, keep their hands down by their side either here or here, and have them jump up and down like this, which you saw in the first dance of the thing. And we're not going to have any solo dances. We're going to have all group dances, except for two solo events in this whole thing. One is not really a dance, a mime, where the oldest and wisest member of the tribe comes down and kisses the earth. And then, of course, the one major solo, the sacrificial dance at the end of the ballet. Everything else is done in groups. So he's trying to be, I think, just the opposite of what a ballet would be. When you see the reconstruction by Millicent Hodson of Nijinsky's choreography, I think you think, if you're anything like me, that the boy knows what he's doing. Oops, wait a minute, It goes on, but that's the dancing you do to that music we just listened to. Stravinsky spent a lot of time saying, at the time he gave an interview, said, Nijinsky is the perfect collaborator I have found in this young man, the perfect person to work with. He later repudiated that interview, and for a lot of the rest of his life, Stravinsky spent a lot of time making fun of Nijinsky.
The dancers has been rehearsing for months. They knew what they were doing, at least. Even so, what they're doing often had nothing to do with the music. Nijinsky would say to me, I will count to 40 while you play, and we will see where we come out. He could not understand that, so we might at some point come out together, This did not mean we had been together on the way. The dancers followed Nijinsky's count, too, rather than the musical count. He spoke Russian, of course. And as Russian numbers above 10 are polysyllabic, 18, for example, 18, in the fast tempo movement, neither he nor they could keep up.
You can tell that he's reading a text that he can barely pronounce. You can hear him fear the fact that the word polysyllabic is coming up. You can hear it in his voice, oh God, I'm gonna have to say polysyllabic here in a second. So how much this is Stravinsky speaking, we'll never know. But anyway, this is the kind of statement he makes. I wanna think for a minute about a piece, the glorification, the dance that we saw in that sketch where the young woman danced around. This is the piece, you know it. It's what the dinosaurs were dancing to. You know that piece? It's made out of just almost invariable blocks of music put together in patterns. And so what I've done here is just indicate with letters A, B, C, D, E, the five things that Stravinsky sort of xeroxes and uses over and over again, putting them together in patterns. There's also a letter F in the third line you'll see there. It's a thing that he uses only one time, and it's a way of sort of signaling, holding back before the arrival back at sort of what actually sounds like home territory. So a tour of just the first line would show, first of all, a lot of A's. We talked about it just the other day. That's A5. And you'll notice that a capital A is always followed by a little 5. The numbers are how long they last, a count. So it's not variable in length, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And a little A is the same harmony, but variable in length, a kind of a static rather than a dynamic thing. So it could go 1, 2, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's how that works. And there's something called B, which you'll recognize as B is something that's always the same. It starts down low and it goes up high and it goes faster and faster. But the different instruments start at different times, and B is always underway by the time you hear it. So B kind of sounds like letter C is just another one of those found harmonies Stravinsky finds at the piano. C is counted slow, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Whereas A is counted twice as fast, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And that's all you need to know. This is the piece that begins after those great big 11 kind of drum beat chords. See? You can follow that. And you'll see there's a group of A's on the beginning, a group of A's on the end, and something else in the middle, a lot of B's and C's with one red herring of an A5 stuck in. What a crazy way to compose music. Stravinsky is doing just what Handel and Beethoven does. You look at there's an A5, and then there's another A5. So that sets up a pattern, and you expect a repetition of that pattern. Handel does the same thing, only he goes, hallelujah, 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 and surprises you. Stravinsky goes, something different. And then he returns to another A5 right here. So in a way, he's making, out of completely different sonic material, something kind of like Beethoven's song form. Do you remember how the first line, da 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 da, just like the second line? Da 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 da. But the third line is completely different. Da 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 da. The fourth line returns to the music of the beginning. Da da da. Well, it's actually just what Stravinsky is doing right here in this opening thing. That was just the first line here. Let's listen through this. The middle line there is all D's and E's. You recognize D, it's yet another harmony. starts with a great big bass drum beat, and E is quiet and goes boop, 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 boop. That's all that happens in the middle line. There's something called F that happens only once to lead us back, and it's all A, B, C, D, E. Easy to follow. I said that D begins with a great big drum beat. I lied. The Ds that don't have parentheses around them begin with a great big drum beat on the bottom of the orchestra. The ones with parentheses are the same harmony, but instead have a kind of a squeal of trumpets on the top. But I think you can follow this perfectly well, and you just get started with the 11 chords. Then it just stops. You can follow this. Notice the Stravinsky gives us a lecture in three-part forms. The top part is something, something contrasting, and a return to the opening stuff. The middle line is something, something else with a red herring in it, something else, and then a mixture of the two. And the third line makes the whole overall piece be yet another kind of three-part form. A first thing that returns to something, a middle thing, and then so that the whole form is something, something different, and a return to the opening, but purified of all the non-A material. And that last line, as you'll see, is exactly the same as the opening A section and the closing A section of the top line. So the hope is to get people actually to listen to this. Now you have to think about going in the Théâtre des Champs-Élysées, dressing up like in this foyer with that beautiful ironwork like these people. This is a picture of the opening of the theater, not of the thing itself, and being in this thing where these people do all of this, look at this elegant, ultra-modern theater, screaming while the dancing happens on stage and this strange thing happens. Stravinsky describes, and this is one place I feel sympathy for him, he describes his experience there.
At the performance, mild protests against the music could be heard from the beginning. Then, when the curtain opened on a group of knock-kneed and long-breathed Lolitas jumping up and down, danced this adolescent, the storm broke. Cries of, "A girl!" came from behind me. I left the hall in a rage. I was sitting on the right near the orchestra, and I remember slamming the door. I have never again been that angry. The music was so familiar to me. I loved it. And I could not understand why people who had not yet heard it wanted to protest in advance. I arrived backstage in a fury. There I saw Daggerev switching the house lights on and off, and the hope that this might quiet the hall. For the rest of the performance, I stood in the wings behind Nijinsky and holding his jacket while he stood on a chair shouting numbers to the dancers like a coxswain.
Imagine, who can imagine? If you'll indulge me, I'd like you to watch with me, it only takes about 2 minutes, the reconstructed Nijinsky choreography of that dance that's with the A's and B's and C's and D's. Because I think, I want to convince you that Nijinsky is a brilliant choreographer. What he does is for every motion in the music, there's a motion in the choreography. Stravinsky didn't like that, and a lot of choreographers don't like that, and for a lot of other things, he didn't do that, but for this piece, he did. And I never, at least, listened to that piece the same way after I've followed along with this. Performance. Next year will be the 100th anniversary of the premiere of The Rite of Spring. Isn't it amazing that a piece that's so old could seem to so many people so shockingly modern? I don't know why that is, but there's something about Stravinsky that really, really nailed it that time.
It's one of the great collaborations in which not only Stravinsky but other artists brought into existence one of the seminal, most important, and coolest works of 20th century ballet, music, theater.